So I'm going to be talking about 23 years of software side channel attacks here. For those of you who don't know me, I recognize some faces out here, but it's my first time in this part of the world. So I know there are some people out there that I haven't met yet. I've been a FreeBSD developer since 2004. My first contributions to FreeBSD were writing FreeBSD Update and Port Snap. These days, I maintain the FreeBSD EC2 platform. I spent almost 7 years being FreeBSD security officer. Relevant to this talk, I'm an occasional cryptographer. I wrote two papers, one in 2005 on a side channel attack against shared L1 caches, and in 2009 about S-Crypt. My day job is as the author of Tarsnap. Tarsnap's slogan is online backups for the truly paranoid. That is my full-time job. That is what is paying for me to be here. So I'm talking about software side channel attacks. What do I mean by this? Well, we like to think of things as being black boxes. Input comes in, something happens, output comes out. But in fact, all of these black boxes leak information in a number of different ways. So you have electromagnetic radiation. Those of you in the older segment of the audience may remember Tempest, the idea that you could be parked down the street from someone and see everything that they had on their CRT display, because CRTs were very noisy electromagnetically. You also have power consumption attacks. These are used a lot against embedded systems. Sound. It turns out when a processor uses more or less power, it heats up a little bit, and just that heating means that things expand or contract, and you can measure that with a really good microphone, of course. Even though it's not audible to us, it's enough signal to pick up in some cases. Of course, you have input coming in and output going out of this black box, but it takes time for that to happen, and often measuring how long that takes is useful. And then also, often these black boxes have internal state, which can be retrieved later. There's a famous story about a keyboard which could not be used in some high security locations in the US because it had an internal 4-byte buffer. And the government was concerned that information could be exfiltrated by having it plugged into a secure system. Something goes into that buffer, the keyboard moves to an insecure system, and the data is run out of that buffer. If you're leaking information deliberately through any of these channels, we call it a covert channel. This is relevant in things like mandatory access control, where you've got a system which is shared between people with top secret clearance and people without top secret clearance. You want to make sure that the people with a high clearance cannot deliberately leak something to people who will be less scrutinized as they walk out the building with it. If you're leaking information accidentally, we call it a side channel. So for all this talk, I'm talking about ways that we can steal information that is not being deliberately shared with us. Software side channels, it's the channels you can exploit just from software. So you won't be able to exploit electromagnetic radiation or power consumption or sound very easily unless you're close to the device you're monitoring, because you need hardware to pick up those signals. Time, on the other hand, easy to measure that in software. And then if you can actually get something that we care about, you have an attack. Typically what we're concerned with is cryptographic secrets. There's two reasons for this. First, historically, if you're using cryptography, it's probably something important. Either the secret itself you're encrypting is important, or the keys you're using are important because they will let you steal some other information. This isn't necessarily true these days. These days, if you're watching cat videos online, you're using TLS. So now the presence of cryptography doesn't necessarily mean that there's anything important. The other reason that we care about cryptographic secrets is that they are generally very small. Cryptographic keys, AES, you're looking at 128 bits, maybe 256 bits. These side channels, they have limited bandwidth. So given a certain amount of time, if you're going to get anything of value, it's got to be pretty small. So I said 23 years of history. Well, I'm going to start 42 years ago. 1977, Rivest, Shamir, and Edelman published the RSA cryptosystem. This was the first published asymmetric cryptography system. In fact, it had been discovered in the UK, I think 4 years before this, but it wasn't published. People inside GCHQ tend to not publish their research. At the time, it was more or less a mathematical curiosity. There wasn't software available for using it. The computers at the time, it would take a long time to do these calculations. So you could do it, but I don't think anybody really did in any serious way. June 1991, however, Phil Zimmerman published PGP. These days we have GPG, which is the free software version of that. But this now made RSA available to the general public. There was code that people could download and run. And also around this time, computers were fast enough that it was practical. The US government was very unhappy with this. They tried to throw Phil Zimmerman in jail on a charge of exporting munitions, because at the time, cryptography was considered to be a weapon of war. It turned out that if you take your source code and publish it in a book, then Second Amendment says you can export books. So that solved that problem. But it's a very interesting story if you haven't read it. But at this still isn't quite where my story starts, because PGP, you're generally using it offline. You download your email, you type in your passphrase, you decrypt the email, you read it, you apply sometime later. It's difficult for someone to monitor how long this is taking, because there's other human factors involved as well. So where things really get started is February 1995. We now have the World Wide Web. We now have websites that want to take money from people, which means credit cards, which means they want some security. Where do they turn? Of course, they turn to RSA. But now it's not a case of a message comes in and a human looks at it and does something with it minutes or hours later. Now it's being used interactively. A packet arrives at your secure web server. It needs to decrypt that RSA encoded message in order to complete its handshake. You don't want your website to take 5 minutes to load. You want it to be as responsive as possible. And so now there's, for the first time, a real opening for side channel attacks against RSA. And the very next year, Kocher published this paper, Timing Attacks on Implementations of Diffie-Hellman, RSA, DSS, and Other Systems. All of these systems have in common the fact that they use modulo multiplication, modulo large numbers like 256 or 512 bits. And at the time, all the commonly used implementations of these had non-constant time modulo multiplication. If you can predict which multiplications will take longer and which multiplications will complete faster, what you can do is provide an input where if the key that's being used has a one somewhere, it will be fast, and if it has a zero, it will be slow, or vice versa. This allows you to go through the private key, one bit or sometimes two bits at a time, and just send in different inputs, measure how long they take, and extract those bits one by one. So this allowed Kocher to steal an RSA key in about 1,000 RSA operations. So this is an attack, but it wasn't necessarily a practical attack. At the time, a private key operation was around 400 milliseconds. The fast modulo multiplications were around 20 microseconds faster than the slow ones. So that's a signal which is 1/20,000th of the total time being spent on the RSA operation. And to make it worse, networking at the time, fast Ethernet had just been released, but a single packet could take 120 microseconds to transmit. So if one packet gets in the way and slows down your response, that's six times the signal that you're looking for. So it's an attack, but not necessarily one that you could use over the internet. But important to remember, in security, attacks always get better. 2003, Bonet and Bromley published a paper, Remote Timing Attacks Are Practical. They attacked RSA in a slightly different way. They were looking at a a timing channel in Montgomery reduction using Chinese remainder theorem. That doesn't matter. The important thing here is, rather than measuring how long one operation took, they measured how long lots of operations took. And just like with public opinion polling, if you poll four times as many people, your margin of error goes down by a factor of two. If you average n operations, you improve your signal-to-noise ratio by a factor of square root of n. So they were stealing RSA keys not by timing 1,000 RSA operations, but by timing 2 million operations. It takes longer. In their paper, they say a typical attack takes approximately 2 hours. So the joke at the time was, if your secure web server is suddenly pegging its CPU at 100% for 2 hours, you know you're being attacked. Of course, if you were actually attacking someone, you wouldn't do this. You would spread the load a bit, so it's not so obvious. But that attack, which in 1996 was purely theoretical, at this point it really is real, and people need to fix their side channels. So how do you defend against this? The standard defense is called blinding. The Kocher and the Bonet-Bromley attacks both make use of chosen inputs to find either the secret exponent or the prime, depending on the attack. This is very common in cryptography. If you can choose what values get fed into your opponent's cipher, it gives you a lot of extra power to attack it. This is, in fact, something that we look at in designing protocols. If you can design your protocol to minimize the extent to which your opponent can send you their choice of inputs, it makes it a lot harder for them to attack, even if hypothetically they have an attack against the underlying cipher, which, you know, hopefully they won't, but these things happen. So the way that blinding works is, rather than simply calculating x to the power d, which is how RSA decryption works, you pick a random value r, raise it to the power e, which is the encryption exponent, then multiply that by x. That's the value that you then raise to the power d, and then you remove the factor of r that you multiplied in later. Because r to the power e to the power d, modulo n is just equal to r, it's easy to divide that out at the end. Because the encryption exponent e is much less than the decryption exponent d, you can do the additional math here very quickly. Compared to the overall cost of the RSA decryption. Typically, you're looking at maybe a 2% performance cost here. But as long as the random value R is chosen differently for every exponentiation, so a completely new random value each time, there's no way for the attacker to predict what value you're actually going to be feeding into your modular exponentiation routine. And so there's no way that their chosen ciphertext will reveal anything to them. They can time as much as they like. All they're going to see is, no matter what input they give you, it's a random amount of time it takes. Moving on, the very next year, we saw an attack on AES. And this is where things start getting more interesting. Bernstein published this paper, Cache Timing Attacks on AES. AES is the advanced encryption standard. This is the standard way we do symmetric encryption these days. Straightforward implementations use something called SBOX table lookups. Roughly speaking, you take one byte and you look it up in a table to read four bytes out. So you've got a kilobyte size table. AES runs in multiple rounds, but in the first round, the bytes that you're looking up are the bytes of your key XORed with the corresponding byte in the input that you're encrypting or decrypting. Now, if certain table offsets take longer to access than others, what you can do is try a whole bunch of different inputs and see which value XORed with this unknown key lands in that spot that you know takes particularly long to access. Well, if you know where it's ending up after the XOR and you know the input, then it tells you what that byte of key was. And it turns out that, yes, the time it takes to look something up in a table is not going to be constant. There's cache occupancy, so whether the data that you're looking up is actually in the cache at that moment. There's load-store conflicts, so if part of the cache is being read from and being written to at the same time, not the same location in memory, but the same part of the cache, one of them will be delayed by a clock cycle. If you have cache bank conflicts, so if you're reading two different values that happen to end up in the same part of the cache, one of them will be delayed by a clock cycle. So we like to think of, you know, caches run in X cycles. Well, no, they run in X, sometimes X plus one, sometimes X plus two cycles. And there's enough signal here that Bernstein could steal an RSA, steal an AES key from himself. This attack involved timing roughly 1 billion random reports. So we've gone from timing 1,000 RSA operations to timing 2 million RSA operations to timing 1 billion inputs to AES. Interesting though, these are random inputs. He did not need any chosen inputs here. So the way we defend against these sorts of attacks now, modern CPUs all have hardware AES circuits, so use them. Don't do it in software if you can possibly avoid it. There are ways to do AES in software without side channel attacks, but they are very complicated and very slow. You want to use the hardware. The next year, this is my contribution to this talk. At BSD CAN 2005, I published this paper, Cache Missing for Front-End Profit. Thank you, Dan, for accepting the talk. I submitted this talk to Dan in December 2004. I think the title of the submission was A Yet-to-Be-Announced Security Vulnerability, and the abstract was, I can't tell you yet. And Dan, I guess, somehow had confidence in me. He didn't know me. I'd never been to the conference before, but he accepted the talk on the basis of, I can't tell you what I'm going to be talking about. But this was an attack on symmetric multi-threading, so Intel hyper-threading in that particular case. And the way it worked is you pull data into the L1 cache, and then a moment later, you time how long it takes to access the same data again. If your data is still in the cache, it will be fast. If the data is no longer in the cache, it will take longer. In this particular case, we're sharing the L1 cache with another hyperthread, which, in order for this attack to work, is going to be running cryptographic routines. In my case, I was attacking OpenSSL's RSA implementation. So by measuring how long it took me to access my data, I could determine, did OpenSSL access something that ended up in that same part of the cache? Unlike all of the previous attacks I've talked about, I was never measuring how long a cryptographic operation took. There was one that was going on at the same time, and I was timing something, but I was not timing the cryptography. I was timing my own memory accesses to my own data. So people sometimes call this a timing attack. It is not a timing attack. This is a new type of attack. This is a microarchitectural side channel. And I'll be talking a lot more about these later. Microarchitectural side channels are very interesting because they can have much higher bandwidth. If you're timing how long an operation takes, RSA for instance, you know one number, how long did it take. That might give you one bit of information. Was it fast? Was it slow? It might give you a bit more. Was it very fast? Was it slightly fast? Was it slightly slow? Was it very slow? More often, it will give you less than one bit of information. It might have been slightly faster than average, or it might have been slightly slower than average, and you need to do multiple timings to get even one bit of information out of it. But with microarchitectural side channels, there's a lot more bandwidth, and in fact, in this case, I was able to steal the RSA private key just by looking at one operation taking place. Because I was reading information out of the cache state all the way through the RSA operation, and rather than just having one value, there were multiple different cache sets. So here you can see a slide I had in that talk in Ottawa. Yeah, it looks like it's legible there. So you can see a bit of a repeating pattern. Most of the repeating pattern is what happens in the cache when OpenSSL is squaring a number, modulo n. The x-axis is the cache congruency class, so there's 32 cache sets in the particular processor I was looking at. So every time data is pulled into L1 cache, it ends up in one of those 32 sets. The y-axis is time. for some reason, starting at the top and moving downwards. The dark cells in this picture are, it took longer than normal to access that data. If it's light, it means we were able to access the data very quickly, meaning our data is still on the cache. OpenSSL did not displace our data. So in addition to the squaring, as you can see, there's some places where there's module multiplication happening. There's also a few places where you see horizontal lines. I think those are clock interrupts, but I'm not entirely certain. But as you can see, this is just a bit less than 1% of an RSA computation happening here. There's a lot of information we're reading out while this is happening. A couple of months after I published my paper, the team of Osvik, Shamir, and Tromer published their own paper, which essentially used the same approach of looking at the shared L1 cache, but they were looking at AES instead. As with my research, they showed that the hypothread could monitor the operation, which was sharing the L1 cache while it was going on. Going a bit beyond what I did, they also looked at stealing AES keys after an operation had completed. So in their case, they were looking at the Linux DM crypt, which is like Jelly, I guess. It's an encrypted disk, encrypted using AES. And what they did is they created this encrypted disk, they created a file system on it, and then they would, from user land as an unprivileged user, write something to a file on that disk. And so they make the write system call, it goes through the kernel, it ends up in the encryption code, ends up, gets written to a disk, and then returns back to user land. And then they look at the state of the L1 cache. And there's enough information still left behind, even after returning from the kernel, that they were able to steal the AES key from the Linux kernel. Their attack took between 100 and a million AES operations, depending on the CPU. Intel CPUs took longer than AMD CPUs for some reason, or there was more noise in their measurements, which meant it took longer. And also the method of attack. So it's a lot easier, and it takes fewer measurements if you're monitoring it while the operation is taking place. It's slower if you're only looking at the state of the cache after the operation takes place. But fortunately, we know how to guard against these attacks. What you need to do is make sure that your code and your data accesses do not depend on any secrets. So you don't have any conditional branches which depend on your secrets. You know, if statements, selection operators, for and while loops. You can have for and while loops, but they need to be loops that will run the same number of times regardless of your secrets. So you can't have a for this byte of key is equal to this byte of data do something, but you can say for I equals 0, I less than 10, I plus plus. You can say run this loop 10 times, but you shouldn't have anything that involves any secrets in there. In some cases, this means doing extra work. If for whatever reason your algorithm involves a conditional operation, if this, then call this function, if not, then call that function. In order to avoid these side channels, you need to do both operations and then combine the results of those functions later. Because if you just run one of those functions, then you can see in the cache footprint the difference between those two operations. Just like you can see in this graph here, the difference between a squaring and a modular multiplication. But there's a side benefit to this, even though it's a lot more work to write your code to defend against these attacks. It also protects you against any sort of timing side channels, because even though your code won't necessarily take the same number of cycles every time, caches may help you or may hinder you, but as long as your secrets aren't involved in any of these things, somebody may time you many times and they'll just get random differences from one run to the next. Those won't tell them anything about your secrets that you're trying to protect. And of course, as I said before, over time attacks get better. So in 2005, I wrote this paper about attacks on the shared L1 cache. Intel claimed they had an attack on a shared L2 cache. As far as I know, they never published this. I'm slightly skeptical of their claim because they were making this claim while they were trying to convince me that, oh, this really isn't a big deal. You don't need to give a talk about this. Please don't give a talk about this. Hey, Yahoo, if Colin gives a talk about this, can you fire him? It turned out he didn't work for Yahoo, but they thought he did. So they were trying to convince me that this wasn't an issue because it affects L2 caches anyway. They never published the work. Take it with a grain of salt. But leaving that aside, attacks get better over time. In 2006, there was an attack that used CPU branch predictors. 2007, the L1 instruction cache. 2015, the L3 cache. This is the last level of cache. So we've gone from two hyperthreads sharing a 16 kilobyte cache to one of 28 cores sharing a 42 megabyte cache or something like that. In 2018, we had TLB cache collisions. This, of course, at this point now, attacks need to have names that are catchy. So this was called the TL bleed attack. Later that same year, we had an attack on shared execution ports. This was going again, going back to hyperthreading, of course. But there's a certain number of execution ports within each core. This was called the port smash attack. There are probably many other attacks that I've forgotten, but these were the ones that jumped out at me as being particularly notable. Point is, over the years, attacks always get better. But also, all of these attacks, if you write code according to the guidelines I put in my paper in 2005, you will be immune to all of these, because all of these attacks exploit either having different code running or the same code accessing different locations in memory. As long as you stick to those two rules of not having secrets involved for those, none of these attacks matter to you. So I'm just going to take a brief detour into CPU architecture. Those of you who took a third year course in university on CPU architecture can go to sleep for the next two slides. CPU pipelining has been around roughly since the IBM stretch in 1961. The idea here is you can improve your performance a lot if you start processing one instruction before you finish processing the previous one. So the classic RISC pipeline, you have five stages. You have fetch, you have decode, you have the actual execution of the instruction, you have memory access, and then you have commit, where you write the data back into the permanent registers. Modern pipelines look more like 15 stages. They get a lot more complicated. Starting in 1990 with the Power 1, we started seeing widespread out-of-order execution. Now, I mentioned execution is the middle stage of that RISC pipeline, and in fact, there's a reason we call it out-of-order execution and not just out-of-order instructions. The beginning of the pipeline, where you fetch and decode instructions, that is still in order. And the end of the pipeline, where you commit the operations, that is still in order. But in the middle, where you're running the operations, there things move around. This is actually particularly important on x86 because there's very, very few registers. We've all heard about loop unrolling, where you take a loop which does something many times and you sort of merge multiple steps of the loop together. That's harder on x86, particularly the original x86, which had eight registers, because you simply didn't have enough registers to be doing many things at once. So out-of-order execution, because it brings with it register renaming, you can have data going in and out of one register many times in your code, but in the implementation, it's going in and out of different registers. But the key observation here is more or less the past 40 years of CPU design has been about making sure that instructions will flow. It's very cheap to have another adder or another XOR or even multiplier or even floating point arithmetic. Those are a very small part of your CPU die these days. What's difficult is making sure you have enough parallelism to make use of the extra hardware. And of course, that's why we're now switching to a world of many cores. 15 years ago, one core, two cores, sometimes you have two packages with two cores each. Now we've got a single die with 28 cores, or I think 32 cores. because that makes it a lot easier if you don't need to worry about getting parallelism inside one core. Of course, it sort of punts things over to the developers. Now developers need to make that parallelism explicit. I'm sure you've all been waiting to see the word speculative execution. Pipelining, you've got in all modern CPUs, one instruction starts executing before the previous one has completed. With a slight caveat here, if you insert serializing instructions, that tells the CPU, stop here, do not do anything more until everything before that has finished. So if you work with multi-core systems, you've probably dealt with load fences and store fences. Those deal with memory ordering. This is the same thing for instruction ordering. Sometimes the CPU is going along and realizes, wait, those things I started doing, I shouldn't have started doing them. And then you get a pipeline flush, which means that thing at the end that's just been committed says, everything that came after me should not have happened. Get rid of all of it and start over from the right place. So this happens because of branch misprediction. You've got loops that run a certain number of times, and eventually CPU says, okay, we keep on doing this. I'm just going to start assuming that we're going to keep on doing it forever. Eventually, you exit that loop, and then the CPU says, whoops, I shouldn't have started running it again. So it tosses out the next iteration of the loop and starts out, continues off with what comes after the loop. You've got indirect branch target misprediction. This is, say, if you've got a function pointer you're calling, you know, usually you're actually calling the same function pointer from the same point in your code every time, but just occasionally you might be using a different file system or something that you end up calling a different function pointer. It's very useful to predict this because it lets the CPU get started on the next set of instructions, but it needs to throw that out if it mispredicted. You have exceptions. Things would be a lot slower if CPUs did not just hope that instructions will complete successfully. If you have code where you're doing an integer division, odds are it will succeed, you want to keep on running things. If you get a divide by zero, the CPU has to throw out what it was trying to do and say, okay, wait, raise that exception, and then your code maybe wants to do something with that divide by zero and then go back and continue from that point onwards. Data hazards, you have data being written to memory and read from memory. Sometimes the CPU doesn't realize until too late that it's actually the same memory location, so it needs to reorder things, or it needs to unreorder those operations, rather. Self-modifying code, this was big in the 1990s, less common now that we have write, XOR, execute, but with JITs, I suppose, we can still have self-modifying code. Used to be that you could actually use this to detect which x86 CPU you're running on, because the 8086 and the 8286 and the 8386 had different prefetch pipelines and would read ahead a different number of bytes of code. On modern CPUs, if you write to anywhere close to the location that you're executing from, it just does a pipeline flush because it wants to make sure that you actually execute the instructions that you were trying to execute after changing them. But for whatever reason, if a pipeline flush has happened, all of the speculatively executed instructions are not committed. And so the registers have the values they should have. The architectural state of the CPU has not been affected by the speculatively executed instructions, but the microarchitectural state, those caches, the branch predictors, those things can have changed, and that is where we get into problems. Meltdown, this is sometimes called Spectre V2, but I think this is the sensible place to start with speculative execution attacks. You try to read from an address that you can't actually read from. You know that it's going to raise a fault, but you do it anyway. As soon as you got the value, you use that as an index for an array access. Intel CPUs handle traps when the instruction is committed, at the very end of the pipeline, which means before it gets around to flushing the pipeline, you manage to do your array access. So even though that array access never happened from the CPU's point of view, it still affected the cache, you can still measure its effects. This allows you to do something like I did with hyperthreading, of measuring the state of the cache to figure out what value was it that you were handling which you didn't use, but which had an effect on the cache. Same thing with, it's called rogue system register read. This is the RDMSR, read machine specific register instruction. If you're an unprivileged process, this will raise a fault, but the fault is handled later, so you can actually do something with the value before the fault is handled. Lazy floating point unit state switching. Similar idea. In order to avoid copying data in and out of the floating point unit, BSDs for a long time would simply mark the floating point unit as being not present. As soon as somebody tries to use it, then it raises the exception and the kernel says, okay, let's copy the state in and then mark the floating point unit as being present. It should work fine, but in fact, because a fault isn't handled until later, you can read somebody else's floating point state, do something with it, and then come back after the fault has been handled and read that value out of the cache state. Swap GS, same idea. It's an instruction which is privileged. It will fault, but you can do something before the fault is handled. So all of these issues on this slide, they're a problem because of the delayed execution handling, which is, as far as I know, a particularly Intel issue. AMD has said they don't do it this way. As far as I know, ARM also handles faults earlier or in some way avoids having things that will depend on a faulting instruction and end up executing in this way. And yeah, Intel could have designed their CPUs to not be vulnerable to this. They just didn't think of it, I guess. There's more CPU issues. So I mentioned before data faults. If you're writing to an address and reading from the same address, this is called speculative store bypass. This affects pretty much every modern CPU. You can have a whole long series of instructions which ends up computing an address that you're going to be writing some value to, and until it ends up computing that address, the CPU doesn't know that some other read that you have is reading that same address. If you look at the code that you have written in front of you, or the assembly language code you have written in front of you, it looks like, well, of course this read happens after that write, so you should just read the value that you just wrote to that address in memory. But if you can make the CPU realize too late that it's the same address, you can read the previous value from that memory location and do something with it, leave some sort of footprint in the cache, which you can measure later on. Several issues in the category of microarchitectural buffer sampling. These are only known to exist on Intel, but I suspect that they exist on other CPUs as well. A very common thing that happens in CPU design these days is that there's internal buffers. So if you're storing data to memory, it doesn't go directly into the L1 cache. It goes into a queue on Intel CPUs. I think there's up to 72 values, which are waiting to go into the L1 cache. This makes things faster if, say, there's cache bank conflicts. If the cache is busy with data being read out of it, if it's handing data off to a different CPU because a different CPU is trying to read the data and you have cache coherency issues. So it's very good for performance. And in order to make sure that you get the right values out, every time you do a read, it checks, is this value this address you're trying to read, an address which is listed somewhere in this store buffer. If it is, we'll just forward that value directly without waiting for it to go through the L1 cache. Problem is, sometimes you accidentally forward data that you shouldn't have forwarded. One case I know of is if two hyperthreads are accessing the same virtual location, they may have different paging, and it may actually be different physical locations in memory. But the processor will just sort of hope that it's the right address, forward the data along, you can do something with it, and then later on the processor says, whoops, shouldn't have done that, flushes the pipeline. But at that point, it's too late. You've already stored the data, exfiltrated it somehow through your microarchitectural state. as I say, these are only known to exist on Intel CPUs, but because it is this idea of having temporary buffers is very useful for CPU performance, I suspect that other CPUs have very similar issues. And then, of course, Spectre. This is sometimes used just as the general category for speculative execution vulnerabilities. But what I mean here is really the issues which are not due to a problem in the CPU. So speculative execution is here, and unless we really want to throw out about 40 years of performance improvements, we will need to worry about speculative execution. So bounce check bypass was the first Spectre attack that was published. In this case, you have some sort of bounce check, which usually succeeds. Usually people are trying to access data they're supposed to access. So the CPU has learned that branch usually goes the way it should. After checking that value, data is then read from an address in memory, and then something is done with it. If you feed an address that you should not have access to, you're trying to read past the end of a buffer, the CPU says, well, the addresses are usually inside the buffer, so let's just go ahead and read that, and then do something with that value, and whoops, that branch up there didn't go the way we thought it did, so we'll unroll that, flush the pipeline, but in the meantime, something went on in the cache, which you can read out later. Branch target injection, similar sort of idea, the CPU is predicting a function pointer where control will end up going to, but you can actually trick it into thinking you're going to be calling a different function pointer, at which point code of your choice in the kernel, say, is being speculatively executed. It ends up getting rolled back when the CPU realizes that it mispredicted, but in the meantime, you may have done something. So this is a general issue with speculative execution. If the process misspeculates, you might end up running code that you didn't expect to run speculatively. It won't affect the values in registers, but it may leave some sort of footprint in the microarchitectural state. This affects all modern CPUs. It can happen even if you're not trying to make it happen, because branch mispredictions happen. Modern CPUs, typically you're looking at 98% branch prediction success, but 2% of the time, the CPU is predicting that the branch goes a different way from how it ends up going, and so something is being speculatively executed in those cases, that 2%, which was not what you were trying to execute. The good news here, though, is speculative execution of this nature, so leaving aside the meltdown attacks, it won't bypass the operating system privilege boundaries. You can only speculatively access something that you can access. So sandboxes are your friend. If you're doing something with cryptography and you can put your secret keys into a different process, do that. Keep them as far away from all the rest of your code as possible. I've mentioned two ways of exploiting this. There are many others. One that I haven't seen exploited yet, but I'm sure that it can be done, is in P-code machines. Things like Berkeley packet filter, where you've got opcodes and you've got a big switch statement that says, if this is an add operation, then do this. If it's a subtract operation, do this. If it's a jump to this location in memory and start executing raw code, then do this. If you mispredict where that switch statement is going, bad things can happen. But there's more ways of leaking state than people have been using so far. So far, all of the attacks, bar one, there's one that was just pointed out to me yesterday, but almost all of them have leaked information by leaving footprints in the L1 data cache. Like in that earlier slide where I mentioned all of the different ways that people have attacked shared caches and shared state for side channels, you can also leak information through the instruction cache, through the branch predictors, through the translation look-aside buffer, through the CPU execution port contention. These attacks are only going to get better. Attacks always get better over time. In fact, you can even leak information without executing instructions. Instruction pre-decode loads data from the L1 cache, leaves a footprint there every time it loads a cache line. It then decodes these bytes into instructions, but how long it takes to do that depends on the instructions. If you have a single cache line that has more than four instructions, it will take longer to decode because it can only decode four instructions at once. If you have certain prefix bytes that, say, affect the length of operands between 32 bits and 64 bits, then that also slows down the decoder. So if you can look at how much data got loaded into the code cache before the CPU pipeline got flushed, then that will tell you something about what those bytes were that were being decoded. And so even if the CPU isn't going to execute something speculatively, just by the process of loading those instructions into the decoder, it can leak information about those. If you do have questions later, Fort Meade is about a 54-minute drive from here, and I'm sure the National Security Agency will be very happy to not answer your questions.